I'm going to go ahead and get started. I know that people will continue to join us. My name is Sandy Mayo, and I'm the Vice Provost for Inclusive Excellence. And I am delighted to welcome you to the second annual diversity lecture at Seattle Pacific University. We started this event last year with a desire to bring together thought leaders to campus who can inspire and challenge us to engage the theological, cultural, and institutional aspects of our work around diversity. And normally this event would be face-to-face and we would have a chance to engage with our speakers throughout the day. But in this unusual time, our time today is limited. And for the next hour, we're just gonna have a chance to hear about the work that our speakers are engaged in and how it connects to our theme. So joining us today, we have Reverend Dr. Mae Elise Cannon, who is the Executive Director for Churches for Middle East Peace, Reverend Dr. Grace Ji-Soon Kim, who is Professor of Theology at the Earlham School of Religion, and Dr. Randy Woodley, who's Distinguished Professor of Faith and Culture and Director of Intercultural and Indigenous Studies at George Fox University's Portland Seminary. So if you'd like to hear more from our panelists after today's session, I invite you to listen to their chapel sermons on the University Ministries YouTube channel. I also encourage you to check out their latest publications. Each of them, they're very prolific writers, and they've published new books this past year that are quite prescient considering the pandemic year we're all going through. In just a moment, I'll ask each of our panelists to share a bit about themselves, but before doing so, I just want to say a few words about today's theme, Justice and Shalom. The selection of our theme at this particular moment was intentional, and the selection of our speakers was equally purposeful. Just last month, we entered a new decade and closed another. It's a time that's been marred by deep divisions racially, politically, and culturally. Those divisions are felt within the church, they're felt in our communities, and on our campus. It's a time when our nation's history is at our heels and chasing after truth. It's a time when the groaning of our world cannot be ignored, and it requires a response that seeks a holistic vision of God's plan for shalom. It's also a time that demands a more comprehensive justice. Today's session is just a beginning conversation. I mentioned we have just 1 hour, but what we seek to do today is to really just expand our imagination of what can be different coming out of this pandemic time and to help us find application for our gospel hope. So I want to spend some time now hearing from our panelists, and I'm sure you do as well, as they share some insights with us from their work and leave us with a call to action as well. So I'm just gonna go ahead and get started and ask each of our panelists to share a little bit about themselves and their relationship to today's theme. And Mae, I'd like to start with you.
Sure. Thank you, Sandy. And it's so nice to see you face to face. I'm sorry we can't be together in person. I have great affection for Seattle Pacific University and have spoken there some over the years. So I'm pleased to be here digitally. I come to you from San Juan Island in Washington State. I now consider myself living in the Pacific Northwest, and it's one of the greatest privileges. I am on territory that belonged to the Salish people, the Salish native tribes, of which there were many. And I wanted to acknowledge that before we begin. You know, I wear lots of different hats. My husband used to say, master of all trades and doctorate of none, because I'm an avocational academic. And so I went and got two doctorates. I have one in spiritual formation and a doctorate in history, where my focus was on the history of American Protestant engagement in the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, which we won't be talking about today, so don't worry. My vocational life now focuses on being the executive director of an organization called Churches for Middle East Peace, which is 30 denominations across the theological spectrum, Orthodox, Catholic, Evangelical. And you want to talk about shalom and peace building. I hope we'll talk a little bit about Leviticus 25 and what peace building looks like in the context of, you know, the mitigation of conflict. But a lot of my professional life focuses on that, based in Washington, D.C. And I'm just so grateful for this conversation. You mentioned, Sandy, this moment in our nation's history and so much brokenness that we've experienced. And my sense is that we haven't even hit the depth of the divisions in our country. And so what does it mean? You said gospel hope. What does it mean for us to have gospel hope in the midst of brokenness? So I'm looking forward to talking more about shalom and justice and what that means in the days ahead.
Thank you, Mae. Grace, will you take a moment to share?
Such an honor to be here. I wish I was on your beautiful campus, but thank you so much for the visit, and I hope to visit another time. So I just love this topic of justice and shalom. I was born in Korea, and at a young age, our family, we immigrated to Canada. And I did all my education there from kindergarten all the way up to my PhD program. And then we moved down to the States. I live in Pennsylvania right now. So that's me living in three different countries. And I think the three different countries have made an impact on my work growing up under racism and also sexism. So much of those two things come into my work, my writing, my ministry, and my teaching. And when we're talking about justice and shalom and peace, you know, Korea right now is the only divided country in the world. So we have North Korea and South Korea. So, you know, Korea, the division, it broke up families and friends, organizations, the whole country. So my heart is always in Korea. So, you know, many of us are working towards unifying Korea, working towards peace in Korea. It's still officially at war because they never ended the war. So, you know, that's where my heart is. And so it's just a pleasure to be here to speak with the students and the faculty. And hopefully we can do it again or something similar like this face to face at another time. But thank you for the invitation.
Thank you, Grace. Randy, not last but not least, will you share as well?
Yeah, thank you for the invitation to be here, Sandy, and to be with such esteemed panelists. I have a lot of respect for the other panelists, so I'm really happy to be here, and I'm going to try not to take up all the time so that we can hear more from them. But basically, my name is Randy Woodley. I'm professor of faith and culture at Portland Seminary, which is part of George Fox University. Been to Seattle Pacific a number of times, spoken, done some workshops and things and chapels, and glad to be back. But I'm coming from you now from the unceded territory, the Kalapuya people in the Willamette Valley in Oregon. And my own background is I'm a United Ketuban Cherokee Indian, and I'm glad to be here and offer whatever help I can bring to this subject. Thanks.
Andy, hang on. I'm going to move to you again because this theme for today is justice and shalom. And you've done quite a bit of work of really unpacking that concept of shalom. And in your 2012 book, Shalom in the Community of Creation, did some intensive work around that. Can you discuss with us the shalom construct that you use to interpret scripture?
Yeah, thank you for asking, because that Shalom, what I call the Shalom Sabbath Jubilee construct, which is there are three elements of really the same thing. And that actually is the gospel. So we've been told that, you know, telling this particular story is the gospel. But if we're going to say what the gospel is, it has to be what Jesus said it is. This whole construct starts in Genesis with this, you know, harmony and balance, the story of, you know, how everything is made, and there's things, you know, the sun in the day and the moon at night and all the waters, and just beautiful story. And then all the way through Genesis 11, we have, you know, places where shalom is broken at basically every level, both personally in families and institutionally. And then we have the laws that talk about Sabbath, which Sabbath is this wonderful construct that we have forgotten about. There's a great book called Sabbath as Resistance by Walter Brueggemann. And he really talks about this Sabbath as being the contrast of a God who basically is demanding of you all the time to a God who actually rests and says, hey, enjoy creation. And within this are these laws, which basically, and guidelines, which are set down to talk about basically letting 1/7 of your land rest, because this is an agrarian society, right? Israel is, ancient Israel. And so 1/7 is set aside for who? For the poor, the disenfranchised, the widows, the orphans, the immigrants, for wild animals. And then also the land itself rests from this overtaxing. And so this whole Sabbath construct is really important, that we, as part of creation, as part of the community of creation, also rest and enjoy the creation that Creator has given us. And then we have, of course, Israel's story of straying, and the prophets calling us back to this shalom justice. So this justice and peace is really, if you had to just pick two words, there's a lot more in shalom, like, you know, abundance and economic security and safety and all these kinds of things that, that fall under this large category of shalom. But justice and peace, you know, sum it up pretty good. And so that's what the prophets are calling us back to throughout all the Old Testament. And then when Jesus comes on the scene in Luke chapter 4, his message of who he is and his purpose here is to bring this shalom jubilee construct. He says that he is jubilee, and he doesn't mean that in a spiritual way, just a solely what we would quote unquote spiritual, but a very structural way, a way that affects every aspect of life. And if he was just saying, like, I'm coming to bring this to you personally, which is sort of the message as evangelicals that we've taken and said, well, this is what it's about. No, people wouldn't have tried to kill him afterwards. But he's saying we have to change the way that we live, and we have to be called. So shalom is this something old and something new. It's something old that's been renewed. And Jesus is exhibiting what it's about. And what is it about? It's taking care of the poor and the marginalized and disenfranchised. It's about being a model community so that others in the larger community can look on and say, I want to be a part of that. How do we make that happen? So, and then these laws that are safety nets, like throughout the Old Testament, don't glean the edges of your field, you know, leave 1/7 of your field. So if you remember this, all these different people who own property and 1/7 of their land is left for those who don't own land, then there's a whole lot of food for animals and people, and there's an abundance that can be taken care of. And so we need these strong safety nets in place if we're going to fulfill what Jesus is telling us. And then in sort of a personal level, we finally get down. And the personal level of shalom is really a byproduct. The prime product is really us as communities and how we operate. It's structured love. But in places throughout the whole New Testament, places like 1 Peter 4:8. So above all, keep fervent in your love for one another, because love covers a multitude of sins. And don't neglect to be hospitable to one another. And don't complain when you have someone in your home. And as each one has received this, all these are instructions about sort of how to treat each other in community, living in shalom. And so from my understanding, you asked for how I'm sort of my lens for seeing the whole thing. The gospel is shalom. And it entails all of this from Genesis all the way through the end. And that's what we have to be about, is creating shalom. And if you want to just boil it down to justice and peace, that's a pretty good start. But I'll also say that it also almost always begins with hospitality and extending ourselves and an openness. So I guess I'll stop there.
That's great, Randy. I love how you're able to unpack that in just a few minutes. And I want to stay there for a bit. And Grace and May, I'd love for you to share what you see as the relationship between justice and shalom, and how you're thinking about those concepts in your own work and in this current moment.
Okay, well, thank you. I could just listen to Randy all day long. You know, I think you just summed up so much of, you know, what Jesus has done and what the whole scripture is trying to tell us. And I'm trying to rack my brain, what else can I add to this conversation of justice and shalom? So when I think about shalom, I think of, you know, Randy just gave good definition, but shalom with God, shalom with others, and then shalom with ourselves. And I think shalom with God, because shalom is also pulling together this relationship of peace. So we need to understand that we need this to build a stronger relationship with God. And then when it comes to others, it's our brothers and sisters, our neighbors. But I think sometimes we forget this, others also include creation, all of creation. And I think Native American scholars and what Randy, you know, his work of creation, it's very important that we create that. And, you know, I do work with the World Council of Churches on Climate Justice. And one of the books I edited was called Making Peace with the Earth. I think we're very familiar as Christians, the term making peace on earth. We say it all the time. We may sing about making peace on earth. But when I was coming up with the title, they insisted that I come up, that I use, because World Council of Churches had used that theme for a year or something, making peace with the earth. And they wanted to emphasize with, because they wanted to emphasize that it is with all of creation. It's not just, you know, when we think of on earth, we just think of the human beings walking around on earth, but it is with everything that God has created, the land, the sea, the trees, the animals and the birds and the fish and humankind. So I think, you know, when we think about shalom, it goes beyond just the human connection, but with all of creation, which really means we need to take care of everything. If we are called to be stewards of the earth, then we take care of, rather than taking everything and just being greedy about, I just want to live a bit more comfortable, I need this to, you know, feel good for the day, etc. So I think shalom, you know, with God, with others, and then with ourselves, we need to have peace within ourselves. And I think, you know, these days when you see, you know, we're in the middle of this pandemic, and, you know, I have three kids at home, two are supposed to be away, but they're home, and you see the reports of young kids, children under depression, committing suicide now. Even in Japan last fall, they said more people had died in that month of October of suicide than COVID in all of Japan. So I think we need this shalom within ourselves, this peace. And I think that is so important, because we sometimes forget about ourselves. And I think during this time of pandemic, perhaps as students at Seattle, you know, it is very difficult. It is hard, you know, if you're an extrovert, to be isolated at this time and trying to, you know, maintain some sanity. I think having this sense of shalom within ourselves is very important. And then to tie that in with justice, you know, I think the three of us, our panelists today that you invited, we are all concerned about some form of justice. And to me, you can't have one without the other. You can't have just justice and not have shalom, or shalom and not have justice. These two come together and they work together. It's like two sides of a coin. We work for justice so that we can have peace, and we have peace if there is justice. So I hope that whatever task that the listeners today and the participants, all the wonderful people at Seattle Pacific University, that we will both strive to have both of these, that we will have justice, that we will work towards justice, and that we can have shalom in our lives with our relationship with God, our relationship with each other and with all of creation, which is all the animals and everything on the earth, and with ourselves. I think those three kind of relationships are crucial, especially at this time of the pandemic. So I'll pass it on to Mae now.
Thank you, Grace. Thank you for the words that you shared, and Randy as well. I feel like you're giving me words to be able to articulate some of what I've experienced over this last year. Personally, and I shared some of this in the sermon, I've had some very significant loss, and yet being here on this island has been redemptive. And I think it has to do with peace with the earth, and creation actually can carry the pain of injustice and be a redemptive way that God is at work in the world. And I feel like both of you have given some words and articulation to some of the things I've been feeling spiritually just in this space. And as that relates to shalom and justice, a lot of my work has been on what justice looks like biblically and how the evangelical church can engage or does not engage constructively with issues of justice. And so one of the word studies I think is the most constructive that I was introduced to, and I wrote about it in my first book, Social Justice Handbook, is about how often in the scriptures we see justice, the word for justice, and the word for righteousness side by side. And I think it's interesting. I almost wonder if shalom is when you have both. Right? Justice and righteousness are the foundation of God's throne, and we can't be fully present, and the kingdom of God can't be fully manifested until we have both justice, you know, and peace represented. And it makes me think, I was doing a bit of that word study at Bar Ilan University in Israel, and one should never do a word study in Hebrew with native Hebrew speakers. and so I was in this class, there were no Christians in the room, you know, there were religious Jews and secular Israelis in the room, and we were looking at Leviticus 25, which I often think of as the epitome of what Randy was talking about in terms of Shalom, Sabbath, and Jubilee. So what does the Jubilee look like? It's spelled out in Leviticus 25, that the poor will be poor no longer, the prisoners will be set free, injustices will be made right, you know, creation will be fully redeemed. And I was talking to these native Hebrew speakers, and they said, but Mae, Shalom doesn't appear at all in Leviticus 25, the word Shalom in Hebrew. Which I think is actually really significant for this conversation, because I think my understanding of biblical shalom is that it's an all-encompassing term that means all of those things. So in Leviticus 25, you see Sabbath, and you see Jubilee, and you see justice. And so even though the Hebrew word shalom doesn't appear in Leviticus 25, it's a term that encapsulates all of those things. And so I thought that was just quite interesting being in that context. And my only other comment about justice and peace that I think is helpful in this introduction, you know, I do work on peace building in the Middle East. And when you work with Israelis and Palestinians, peace and justice are considered bad words for one or the other. So one side, Israelis, for example, will talk about peace. And for them, peace means lack of violent conflict. It means, you know, lack of rocket fire. It means you know, the lack of escalation of violence. And so Israelis will often talk about peace being a really good thing, but they see justice as being a threat because of, you know, perspectives from the other side. Whereas for Palestinians say you can't have peace without justice. Justice is the word that they esteem. You know, they're working against a military occupation that's been going on, you know, since the mid-1960s or 1967 specifically. And so Palestinians esteem justice, and they feel like peace is cheap. We don't want just lack of violence, because we want liberation. And so I think even looking at what does peace and justice look like holistically, you know, taking a geopolitical conflict such as the Israeli-Palestinian conflict and looking at you can't have justice without the mitigation of conflict, and you can't truly have peace unless justice is fully manifested, I think it's really important for us to be able to talk about and understand.
Thank you. This is a great way for us to get started, and we'll be able to weave this concept throughout the talk this morning. But I want to spend a little bit of time also looking at the most recent publications from each of you and what we might be able to draw from that. And Randy, I'm going to start with you. You recently wrote a book titled Decolonizing Evangelicalism, an 11:59 p.m. conversation. And in it, you talk about the importance of decolonizing ourselves. Can you tell us what you mean by that?
Yeah, I think so, hopefully. Yeah, so I co-wrote that with one of my former students, Bo Sanders. He and I do a podcast together. And I give him the heavy lifting on the academic side because he just came out of Claremont. So I was happy to invite him to do that if he did some of the heavy lifting. So I don't want to take all the credit myself by any reason. So basically we have to come to grips. You know, when I teach, I've taught American church history 21 times in my academic career. And I always begin with the first, say the same thing every single time. I say, now there's no such thing as history. And they look at me funny. And I say, there's only histories. plural, right? And what happens is that a careful or scholarly examination of history looks at all sides. It looks at histories. And it's particularly important as people who believe in shalom, that we look at the sort of underside. One thing that's true in history is that might makes right. And so the winners always get to write their version. Well, what about the other side? And so what we have now is a very colonized history. It was meant to prefer and privilege white males, particularly landowning males, right from the beginning. That there's been a lot of attempts to mitigate that, but none of them have been completely successful. And so all of our systems, our education system, our economic system, our political system, you know, most of those, if you look at corporate America, if you look at the Senate, if you look at, you know, in education, there's a, most of those are denominations are run by white males. And so that sort of proves the idea that there has been one history that we've privileged over all the rest. Well, you know, white males aren't the only people who have been a part of making history in this country. And so to decolonize ourselves means that we have to stop telling ourselves the lies that we've been taught, that there's only one privileged people, that there's only, and you know, my definition of white supremacy is white normalcy and white privilege, right? And particularly white normalcy is to say, oh, that's what's normal and everything else is sort of a subcategory. And so when we examine our own history and we examine our denominations, when we examine our political system and everything else, it's very clear to see that we've privileged a particular people and a particular race. And so to decolonize means to begin to understand what was behind that, the motives and the reasons, to understand the psychology of keeping that in place, understand why these bad things happen that we see happening since COVID's happened. You know, we've had all sorts of terrible things that have happened. These things are the result of privileging one particular group over the other. And that's a starting place for decolonizing ourselves, is to just say, I have to re-inform myself. I have to begin to convince myself that my reality has been, a lot of it has been either lies or an exaggerated truth. And now I need to hear from everybody and from all sides. That's the first step in decolonizing ourselves.
That's great, Randy. I actually had a follow-up question to that, but I'm gonna try and save it to the end so that we can get through some other questions that we have in front of us. And I wanna give Grace and May some time to also talk a little bit about some of the concepts and their latest publications. I'm going to go ahead and start with May. In Beyond Hashtag Activism, which just came out 2020, you call readers to look at the many issues of domestic and global injustice that impact our world today. And you argue that viewing these issues in isolation is really inadequate, and instead we need what you call sort of comprehensive methodologies that look at the common themes, trends, and dynamic aspects of our broken and unjust systems. And I was just hoping you could talk a little bit about what those methodologies are, what you mean by having a more comprehensive methodology to approach injustice.
Sure. Well, and I think this relates directly to what Randy was talking about in terms of decolonizing. One of the things we historically have done, not just in writing history, but in academia, is that our different fields of study are very isolated from one another. You know, they're not interdisciplinary. And so you'll have sociologists who are experts on certain things who aren't talking to, you know, anthropologists, or historians who aren't talking to, you know, contemporary people who understand sociology. And so we miss so much because of this isolation. And that happens in academia, but it also happens in the way we view problems in the world. And so, for example, I can't tell you how many articles I saw written about how COVID-19 doesn't discriminate. Everybody who gets COVID, you know, they will either have a severe response or not, but it doesn't matter if you're rich or poor, it doesn't matter the color of your skin, COVID doesn't discriminate. And I would say that's fundamentally not true. COVID has a disproportionate effect on the poor and a disproportionate effect on people who don't have access to healthcare, who don't have access to privileges such as clean water. And so poverty, let alone the correlation between color of one's skin and access to resources, which has to do with racism, you know, which has to do with, let's talk about governments and societies, all of these different issues affect how COVID plays out, you know, in different people groups. Let's talk about men and women who are incarcerated and their exposure to COVID. You know, so I ended up writing an article that an American Baptist publication published called COVID-19 Does Discriminate, because of the way that these different issues of justice are absolutely integrated and not separate. You know, a term that many people might be familiar with is intersectionality, that issues of race, issues of justice, issues of poverty, issues of sexism, you know, any type of injustice, there's a correlation or a thread that connects them. So, you know, if we talk about the environment and pollution, pollution not only is a degradation of our environment and of creation, but it has a disproportionate effect on the poor. And so that's what I'm talking about in terms of methodologies, that we can't look at, you know, different issues in isolation from how they relate to the entire system of the way that the world works.
Great, thank you, Mae. Grace, I wanted to kind of dive into your latest book, Hope in Disarray. Just so timely. In that work, you challenge readers to live with hope for the sake of justice. And I thought that was really powerful to connect the two. And for you, it seems biblical hope is revolutionary. And can you say more about this?
Yeah. Thank you for bringing up my latest publication. So it just came out in December. It's a COVID pandemic book, I guess. You know, as I write, when I first began writing books, they were very highly academic. So, you know, a small group of people will read it and, you know, a few students will read it to reference for a paper that they were working on. So I thought, not enough people are reading my work. So then I just kept writing more for the general public. So I know some of the students at Seattle, your area may not be religion or theology or even spirituality, even in that area. But I'm hoping that as I write more for just the general audience, that people can get a glimpse of God in a different way. So this, you know, it's a collection, I think, of 28 short pieces, beginning with scripture, having a reflection, and then ending it with a few questions. So I focus on hope. And it was interesting, you know, the book came out in December, and then January, all the headlines were, the world is in disarray. You know, the world has gone crazy, especially with what happened January 6th. So, you know, I'm looking at hope in this time where we are living, you know, a very fragile time of climate injustice, of racial injustice and gender injustice. And what gets us people of faith through at times is this concept of hope. So for me, hope is this anchor that we have in God. And sometimes people think, oh, hope is just about being optimistic. You know, right now in Pennsylvania, we have a lot of snow and it's snowing, like as I look outside my window. So being optimistic is, okay, I hope that will stop snowing in an hour. But hope is not this concept, this feeling of being optimistic. It is really this understanding of clinging to God, that it is something that we find in God to anchor us in our day-to-day life, and that hope is not just this feeling, but that it is associated with justice. And that's why it's this kind of revolutionary kind of understanding of hope, that the hope that God gives us, that we ourselves anchor ourselves in every day, will lead us to work for some form of justice. We look around, the world is in disarray. There is so much problem everywhere. Maybe it's in your home, maybe it's in residence, on campus, in your church, your neighborhood, your community, in our country, and in our world. And we need to do something about it. We can't just sit here and you know, us scholars sometimes, we're very comfortable, you know, our ivory tower, we don't have to do anything, we don't have to go out, you know, many of our courses are now online, you don't even have to leave your room. But God requires of us to do something about it. You know, this climate injustice is one of the biggest issues of our time. If we as adults don't fix it, you know, our children, you know, the students right up now on campus who are studying, it's going to affect them and it's going to affect the generation after them. So we need to do something about it. So this hope that anchors us, that kind of makes us who we are as Christians, requires of us not to just sit and do nothing, but to really act and do something about it. Change, you know, climate injustice, we think, oh yeah, the big companies need to do something, but it's actually individuals. We need to do something too to lower our carbon footprint. We do it in our homes. We teach our children. We teach our parents. Whoever we are, we have to do something, even in our homes, even in the residences, even on campus. People have to go more green everywhere. So this is what hope is. And my wish, you know, is for the readers and for those who are listening today, that as we live with hope, that will change us to do something and act and work for some justice.
Thank you, Grace. I'm actually going to go back to a couple of things. I mean, we've been talking a lot about this COVID time and the pandemic and recognition of sort of the racial disparities, looking at the ways in which our earth and the environment is also in this time suffering. But we've also just been in this current moment with a lot of things that we've seen through the elections, that we've seen post-election time. And I don't want to ignore that. And Randy, I'm going to turn to you specifically. Your book was published before the attack on Capitol Hill. But I think it has something important to say about that event. And I'm just curious to know, first of all, why you wrote the book, and then what you think it has to offer in this particular moment as many of us continue to grapple with the conflation of American nationalism and Christianity that was on full display on January 6th.
Yeah. Well, you know, this is a historic moment that we're living in right now. I mean, there's really been nothing like it. The closest thing we keep trying to take a stab at is the Civil War. And so it's really important that people who believe in Shalom, who have the hope that Grace was talking about and who want to see the justice that May's talking about, that we are the people who sort of hold it together. And we have a good perspective to do that if we can really look to Jesus and understand what the gospel is really about. So the reason I wrote the book, and I think it's the same answer for both your questions, evangelicalism has become more of a nationalistic religion than a religion of Shalom. And now one of the things I do is I teach a whole lot of history, right? And so I'm happy to, you know, go toe-to-toe with anyone and trying to understand how that worked itself out. But it's gotten to the point where civil religion has become really the deepest held and probably the most pervasive religion in America. And most of those people would say, oh, I'm a Christian or I'm an evangelical. And it's always been a part of this country's history, but it's taken on some really perverse directions now. And so if we are going to resign ourselves to the Christ who's offered in Scripture and the Christ who's real in our own experiences and our own lives, then we have to do away with those national myths that call us to a different religion. They're calling us to really an idolatrous religion, which is civil religion. And, you know, it was so, I would say blasphemous is a really accurate word to to see the Capitol insurrection and to see, you know, the signs, you know, the like for the Bible and Jesus and all this. And, you know, there's no way to connect those dots. And so, but it was a reality check to show us how far we've actually gotten from Christ. When I was 19 years old and 19, I'm going to give myself away here, but it was October 23rd, 1975, when I said to Jesus that I will follow you. I was 19 years old and I won't look back. You know, I understood there was a cost involved, and I understood it wasn't just about the kind of lifestyle I lived, but it was the way that I fed my brain with stuff. It's the way that my intellect had to be developed at that point. And the way that I, of course, had to treat other people. And you make those choices along the way. And when you start believing lies, I know people must have who call themselves by Christ's name must have a check in their spirit. But if you continue to believe those lies, then what you've done is you no longer count the cost, but you've given yourself over to some idolatrous work. And so to me, this was one of the most, the fact that so many of those people said they're followers of Christ is one of the most heinous sort of demonstrations that I could imagine. And I'm sure God just grieves over it.
Thank you, Randy. I'm actually going to jump. We have some questions from our audience, and one in particular that I think I'll pull in at this time because it's sort of related to some of the things that you've been talking about. This question is, how will we prepare and equip ourselves for justice and peace more effectively when in the next 20 years the U.S. will become a majority minority country? The deep discord and violence of the past weeks is either a last gasp struggle against shared shalom and justice or a harbinger of more violent times to come. How might you respond to that, Randy?
Okay, I'll just be real quick because I want to hear from the other folks. But I'm thinking that that things are probably going to get worse. I always like to see the glass half full, but I'm sort of also understand politics and understand where things are going. And so this is a time, a great call for people who follow Christ to basically repent. This is, you know, calling for repentance. Repentance doesn't mean to feel sorry about it. Repentance means to actually turn in the opposite direction, to disentangle myself from all those lies that I entangled myself in, with colonial lies and racist lies and historic lies and national myths, and to go the opposite direction and entangle myself in all the things that move me the opposite direction. And so, you know, I hate to sound old fashioned, but we need to repent.
I think that's right. I'll jump in. And I would point people to a book. It's called Forgive Us, Confessions of a Compromised Faith, that I had the privilege of co-writing, that is based on exactly what Randy just articulated. How do we decolonize ourselves and how do we seek transformation? And I believe the starting point is to acknowledge our sins, even those that are inherited sins, that are things that we maybe not have acted out on ourselves, but we wreak privilege because of the sins of our forefathers. And so I think that's a great place to start. And my only other comment, I really tried to get there in the sermon, but the sermons were so short, you know, 10, 15 minutes. Pain and violence and sin beget pain and violence and sin. And so unless there is a transformative process, you know, thy kingdom come, you know, Lord have mercy, a redemptive process that I believe comes through Christ, unless there is transformation, decolonization, justice being wrought, unless that happens, violence will continue to beget violence. And so I think that's an individual and a corporate process of seeking transformation in Christ so that justice will come and so that Christ's kingdom will come. Because otherwise, degradation will beget degradation. And so may we seek transformation. And I love Grace, I love what you said about hope, and hope inspires justice. I always think hope is the end of justice, right? And so I love that you flipped that around. I thought that was really profound, that it is from our hope, you know, that we'll pursue justice, which I thought was really beautiful.
Well, thank you. I like to flip things around a lot. But anyway, I think it's interesting that, so there were, as Randy and May were saying, I have to say something to, and then I'll go to back to my other thought. But I think the repentance is important. And then before repentance, perhaps, or during repentance, the lament is very important too. I co-wrote a book, Healing Our Broken Humanity, and we focused on, I don't know, seven steps of healing, and one of them was lamenting. So crying out to God. You know, in the Old Testament, we have the Book of Lamentations. And today, in many of our Protestant churches, we don't do any lamenting. So it's a kind of a lost exercise that we've kind of forgotten about as Christians. But I think lamenting and crying out and asking God to help, and that is tied in with the repentance. And I think that's very important. The other thing I wanted to say is, I think sometimes instead of saying Christianity, we might have to just say what it is, which is white Christianity. You know, I teach, and everybody says, okay, I teach Asian American theology, or I'm an Asian American theologian. But my white colleagues, nobody says to them they're a white theologian. You know, it's, but for us, the people of color, there's always some adjective. And I think we have had this white European heterosexual kind of heterosexism Christianity. So we have to name it as such. And sometimes it does not, it distorts the gospel. And as what Randy was saying, the colonialism, the empire building, imperialism is all tied in with this white Christianity. So sometimes we have to name it as such. And sometimes, you know, when we saw the insurrection and when we see this racism happening as if it is this God-given gift to white people, that, you know, there's white privilege and you can just, you know, everything we say is true, everything that we do is correct, and, you know, et cetera, et cetera. When I see that as if it's clothed in Christianity, I would rather call that kind of this national religion or Americanity. It's not Christianity. It's this, it's the cross wrapped in flag and as presented as Christianity, but it's this American ethos, this American ideals that are so far from Christianity. So we got to name these things properly. When we see Christianity that excludes people of color or marginalizes us people of color, name it as white Christianity. Because when I look at the gospel and what Christ shared, Christ was born during a genocide. You know, his family fled to Egypt. He was a refugee. He was an immigrant. You know, he lived in poverty. He was with the poor. He was marginalized. He's from Galilee. What good could come from Galilee? You know, he is what we, the broken people, are, the people of color, women, the marginalized are right now. So if the gospel doesn't preach and reach out to the marginalized, I really question, is this the gospel or is this some white fantasy or white Christianity that has in historically have marginalized? And then people keep saying, oh, then you don't like white people. I'm not saying I don't like white people. I am saying that there is this system set up and it continues to kind of grow with racism. It loves and it just feeds off the racism, and it's the system that I'm against. And we as Christians who are faithful, who want justice and shalom, then need to name this and say what it is and fight against this, because that is not of God. God wants us to live in peace and justice and shalom with one another. And if we are not doing it, we have to question it and ask ourselves, is this the gospel that is being preached, or is it something else?
Great, thank you all. I have two questions from the audience that I really need to pose to you before I ask one additional question that I have for you. The first one is, how do you address concern that the church's engagement in justice is culture-driven or political? And I don't know if maybe just one or two of you want to respond to that.
I'll just start and I'll put a link in the question and answer. I think we have to redefine political. Political just means the way that we engage with one another in society. And so this idea that if it's political, we should stay away from it, or, you know, white evangelicals, I being one of them, in our Sunday mornings, we always say we can't talk about that on Sundays, it's political. You know, and then we have these agendas, you know, not on Sunday morning. And so I think some of it is redefining what politics means, because actually the gospel should pervade every area of our life. And our faith should not only be limited to Sunday mornings. And if it doesn't help instruct how we engage with our neighbor, then we're missing something.
Yeah. And just to add to that, I would just say Jesus was political. He went into the temple and overturned the tables. He challenged the religious leaders. He went into the temple and interpreted. He challenged the status quo. You know, he was there talking to the woman at the well, the Samaritan woman. Who does that? He was being very political. Everything that he did was political. So for me, I think it's really hard to dissociate Christianity from the culture that we live in. And, you know, sometimes people say, oh, it doesn't really matter, the culture. But then that means then this life doesn't matter, and we just think about the afterlife. This life does matter, because when we look at Exodus and God sent Moses to take them out of Egypt, out of slavery, God cared about the circumstances that people found themselves in. And today, God cares about the racism that is killing people, cares about colonialism that is marginalizing people, and we're taking over people. So these are all political issues, but they're cultural issues, and God cared about them. Jesus cared about them. Jesus wanted to upset the status quo. He, you know, the marginalized lepers, he healed them. He was with them. It's when we look at the whole life of Jesus, he was political in every aspect of his life. When he fled, when his family fled to Egypt, it was all a political action. So it's very hard for me to differentiate those two, and culture is just part of it all wrapped up. I'll leave time for Randy.
I'll just say real quick, then we want to move on. You know, we're experiencing a climate crisis. We're experiencing a racial crisis. We're experiencing a crisis of democracy, a housing crisis, an economic crisis. You know, all of these problems are going on in the world that we live in right now. And if you think that they're going to be solved by your personal lifestyle changes and not becoming involved in politics, then you probably ought to see how attached to reality you are.
Here's a follow-up question. As we're talking about these issues, think about this concept of peace. If peace is rooted in God and relationship dynamics, what role does trust play in building shalom out of conflict or injustice?
So I want to start, because I'm going to be really quick. I've been doing this most of my life. I'm an old man now. I've suffered a lot. It's cost my family and I a whole lot throughout the years. I'm not going to get any of those stories. But if you think this is going to sort of just happen without it costing people and your own dedication, then you really need to rethink what your faith's about. Just throwing that in real quick.
The biblical example that came to mind as you were asking that question, Sandy, was Joshua when he was entering into the promised land and he was crossing the Jordan River, and the Jordan River wouldn't part until he stepped in it. And so this trust, I mean, and I think that has to do with, you know, is the question about trust of our neighbor, because sometimes our neighbors are not very trustworthy, right? And yet, what does it say about trust in God? So I just would point to that study. You know, I would point people to taking a look at the Hebrew scriptures of that story of Joshua, and what do we have to step into when we don't know whether the river will wipe us out once we take that step? I think that's a critical part of what it means to act in our faith.
I'm going to butt in real quick. Uh-huh. because I forgot to say the other part of what I was going to say. So the other part of that is, it's, to me, it's always not been about how much I can trust anybody, but about, am I willing to risk and do the right thing? It's about my courage to risk what I know to be right and forget about what others trust or I built trust or anything else. That's not maybe a very, you know, kind way to look at it, but I think it's more about people of faith have to risk rather than build trust. Trust's a great thing if you can do it, but even when it's not, you got to step out, like you said.
And just to add on, many theologians have actually defined faith as trust. So I think if we're going to trust, it is this faith in God. That is really hard to do when you're isolated or marginalized, or when people keep oppressing you. When we think about sexual violence against women, I think somehow we have to learn to trust in God. And God, you know, sometimes we just think God is somewhere out there, and, you know, but God is in our midst. God is with us. The Spirit of God resides in us, in all of us, in all of creation. And I think that gives us hope to work for justice.
Great. I know we have just a few more minutes in our scheduled time. So I'm going to just leave us out with one last question. And then for those who have time, there are some other questions, and our panelists who are available will stay on with us. But just in this last question, so we are a Christian university. And I believe we have a role in this work of justice and shalom. And I'm wondering if you have any thoughts about what the role of Christian higher ed is in working towards justice and shalom. And if so, where do you see the greatest opportunities for us to step into that work? And what would be sort of your call to action for us?
I'll go quickly and then pass it to Randy and to others. You know, I think what was so devastating a couple of weeks ago with the insurrection at the Capitol wasn't just that it happened, wasn't just the sacredness of democracy being challenged, but the fact that there were people doing it, holding flags that said, you know, in the name of Jesus, the fact that Christianity was associated, and I know that there were some questions about, you know, nationalism and patriotism, and I appreciated your defining grace of that's not Christianity, that's America. I can't remember the term.
Americanity.
Yeah. Americanity.
It's just, right? I made it up.
and so in terms of what role we have who self-identify as Christians or as Christian educators, some of it is in defining who Jesus is and in defining what Christianity is all about. And I'm not talking about like a yes, no, one way, you know, history, Randy, right? But a comprehensive expression of good and hope and, you know, and creation and God's glory in a way that's redemptive as opposed to destructive. And so my greatest grief of that capital and those actions was that it was done in Jesus's name. And so I think that puts a lot of impetus and a lot of responsibility on Christian educational institutions of who gets to claim what Christianity is or what evangelicalism is, you know, and how do we return to the good news of the gospel as we seek to define that within society.
Yeah, and to add to that, you know, majority of the higher ed, a lot of the higher ed colleges were the roots are in some Christian denominations. So I'm always happy that there are so many colleges and universities that are rooted in certain denominations. But then many of them have just now become more secular and said, our roots are in whatever Presbyterian or Methodist, but we are. So it's always great that there is still Christian institutions. And when I look at our world here in the US, sometimes the minoritized voices, like the Trumpers, they may be a smaller minority, but they're really loud. Okay, so they're very loud. They have, like, they have the big flags, and they're just very vocal. And then maybe some of us are too quiet. So even though we may be even larger than the other side can be, but we're so quiet, and we just kind of, oh, you know, let it be, whatever. So my point is, for Christian institutions, I think there is a big call to action. Maybe we need to be more vocal and share the gospel in such a way that that more people can hear the good news in a way that is true to the gospel, what Jesus did. You know, Jesus said to, they asked, what can we do? And Jesus said, you know, go feed the poor and clothe the naked and visit the prisoners. You know, when you do it to the least of them, you do it to me. You know, sometimes those actions can speak louder than words, but I think in some sense, we just have to be louder. And I think the Christian institutions like Seattle Pacific University can do these actions or be more vocal in these ways to share the good news, the true kind of gospel message. So that would be kind of my call to action for the Christian universities, higher ed. I think that's a great way for students and faculty and staff to get around these important issues of climate justice, gender justice, racial justice, and work on these issues.
I don't know if I have time to answer, do I?
Jumped on in, Randy, yep.
Okay, so I've worked for four different higher education institutions, Christian liberal arts colleges. I graduated with a bachelor's from a Christian liberal arts college. And so I'm pretty familiar with the whole sort of deal. Homeostasis is that trying to keep everything the same because it's safe. Most institutions, not just Christian higher ed, are homeostatic. They sort of have to keep things the same, and it's mostly because they don't want to upset the donors, right? So one of the biggest secrets on campuses is that students actually are the most powerful people in the institution, because if they're not happy and they all decide they're going to leave, then that institution will no longer thrive. So students have the power to make the changes, and I think if you're not getting the kinds of histories that we've talked about and an understanding of colonialism and how these things have occurred and all that, then you have to go and demand from your institutions that you get a broader education, that this gap between knowledge and actually doing things is somehow closed, because that's this dualism that infects Christianity that says what I know is more important than what I actually do. And so there's a whole lot that students can do it if they will actually do it. So to me, how do you make the changes? Students, you have to organize and you have to make the changes. Don't expect the administration to do it for you.
I want to thank all of our speakers. I know we're at time, but I appreciate your willingness to share from your experience, from your work, from your commitment to issues of justice. And so we'll hang on for those who have some questions remaining. Our speakers can engage with those. But I just want to thank everyone who's joined us today for this conversation. The recording will be made available, but I know that many probably have to jump off the call for now. So I'll pause there. For those who need to transition out, thanks again for joining us. And we will hang on for a few minutes longer to just address some of the questions that have come in. So Randy, Grace, Mae, if you have a few more minutes. So there were a few questions that came in, and I'm just going to go to just a couple of those now before we close out. So the first one that I want to address is a question that came in from a staff member. Would you agree that peace or shalom, properly defined, firstly emanates from our God as a gift and is not a lack of conflict, but proper relationship to God and to each other as defined by him? Is there a better definition?
There's some theological implications in that. First of all, I don't want to say it's a gift. I want to say it is who God is, and so it is normal. So that's the normality we're looking for, right? If it's a gift, that means it's on top of something else. But life emanates. I'm a Trinitarian, emanates from this shalom Trinitarian, what I call the community of creator, of preference and deference to the whole, oneness, and inviting us to join in that normalcy of shalom. And so the first thing I would do is just say that I want to disagree theologically. It may seem picky, but it's not really a gift. It is what is normal and what is expected by God of human beings.
Great. I'll jump to this other question here. How do we begin to speak to our students about justice and shalom when our go-to religious narratives do not speak truth to them? What are your starting points?
That's a very good question. I think, you know, that's the kind of Christianity I grew up in. You know, politics is over here, justice is over here, we don't need to deal with it. You know, growing up in the immigrant church, you know, we were just focused on getting a job and feeding, you know, putting food on the table. That was a priority, and we just put everything on the side. But I think you can't, we like to compartmentalize things, but to look at it more holistically, I think Randy kind of touched on it. I think dualism is a big problem here within Christianity.
You know, emerged in the Greco-Roman period. I think my thing is dying. Hold on. Can you hear me? Okay. I just have to shut off this Bluetooth. Okay, as long as you can hear me. So the dualism, we have to move away from dualism, which says, you know, which divides everything, the whole world, into two different sides. So I think look at it more holistically. We Asians look at it more holistically, recognizing that, you know, the social justice action, shalom, peace, everything that we need to do is all part of the gospel, and you can't really separate the two. The body, the mind, and the soul are all equally important. Within dualism, we keep saying, you know, the spirit is more important than the body. So whatever is at hand, your body is not that important. The body is dirty. Whatever we do with our body is dirty. But I think understanding it more holistically, then we recognize that we need to do all these things. And you can't compartmentalize, but it is a holistic approach to Christianity and what we need to do as Christians.
I'll jump into that one too, if I may. Part of why I did my PhD in history was to seek to understand some of those presuppositions. And I think in that regard, we have to deconstruct. You know, you said, Randy, history is not, there's not just one history, there are histories. And so the deconstructing of how power has translated into, you know, the history that we write. And being multi-narrative and having multiple histories does not mean we're compromising on issues like equality or human rights or justice. And so I think a lot of times this peace and justice, people think if you're in dialogue with people with whom you disagree, you're compromising on justice. And actually, we can esteem the narratives of all while pursuing what justice looks like. And I would point us to the African term Sankofa, that means looking at the past in order to heal and move forward constructively into the future, which is what I think justice is meant to be.
I just want to, there's one last question that we'll address, and then I want to be respectful of everyone's time. So this will be the final from our audience. But are there aspects of shalom that could be ostensibly offensive to certain groups of people in our polarized context? That was an interesting question. I don't know if you have any thoughts about that.
I would ask that person, if we were live and able, to say, what is it that you're looking for in that question? Because to me, the answer is obvious. Yes, if you are a peacemaker, if you are a shalom keeper, or a harmony maker, as I like to say, then you are going to offend people who have different agendas. That is the cost of living for Christ in the world.
I think those who have power always want to maintain power, maintain the status quo. And I think those who are seeking shalom are disturbers of that status quo, because shalom and justice go hand in hand. So yes, people will be offended, and there will be a lot of resistance from those power holders. But I think when we look at the life of Jesus, he stirred a lot of chaos wherever he went. He was upsetting the status quo, turning things upside down, being with women, being with the sinners, healing the poor, and eating with the sinners. So I think, yeah, people will be offended, but the shalom, we are called to be peacemakers And so that is our call, and we do it even though we offend and even though people get upset. We still fulfill the call of God wherever we find ourselves in.
Great. Thank you. Mae, did you have something that you wanted to add?
Amen. I bought Grace and Randy's books while we were in this call, so I just encourage other people to access their resources too.
Thank you. You're a queen of multitasking there.
I was really engaged.
I thought I was a queen of multitasking, but you certainly have beaten me there.
I'm going to go ahead and close this out. And I don't know if there are any last thoughts that you would like to leave us with, just as we're thinking about what do we need to be thinking about in this current moment? If there's one call to action that you would maybe put before us, what would that be?
I think my final word of encouragement is that God cares about justice so much more than we do. And so as we pray the Lord's Prayer, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, we needn't worry about carrying the burden, you know, that we care about justice more than the creator of the universe.
Just to piggyback on May, in Hope and Disarray, I wrote down, one of my PhD professors said, what does let thy kingdom come mean? Right, for the Lord's Prayer. And so, you know, when I don't know the answer, I always put my head down. So I was like, don't ask me, don't ask me. But everybody else, you know, they thought they had the answer, and he said no to everybody. So he said, when we pray, let thy kingdom come, it means let my kingdom go. So I wrote about that in the book. And I think that says a lot, that we love to build our own little kingdoms everywhere we go. And those with power have a bigger kingdom, and we belong to those little kingdom, a part of them. But we have to let it go and let God reign. And when God reigns, well, then we recognize that we need to work for justice and shalom. It becomes easier. Rather than when we try to hold on to our kingdom, then it becomes a task, and it's so hard, and you're so worried about what everybody else is going to say. But when we allow God to come and we let go of our kingdom, then it becomes easier.
Thank you.
So keying off this word kingdom.
I use kingdom, sorry. But anyway, you can use kingdom, but I use kingdom. Yeah.
We know Jesus never actually said that, but yeah. So I make an argument in the Shalom book that I wrote that Jesus would use a term something like the whole community of creation, because we have succumbed ourselves to this dualism so much. It's so pervasive. It's baked in the bread of everything we do, that Jesus would want to make this whole. And so to me, you know, of all the crises which we face, the crisis, the ecological crisis, is the most serious and the most imminent, and the thing that we have to do something about. So much so that my wife and I have a place, I didn't talk about this at the beginning, called Elahe, which is a Cherokee word for shalom, Elahe Indigenous Center for Earth Justice and Elahe Farm and Seeds. And we're basically trying to teach and model to people, to churches, to organizations, how to take care of the earth, how to make change, and how to become change makers in the systems and communities that they're in, so that the earth itself is able to sustain us. Because my understanding is that you know, humans might be expendable, but the earth is going to win in the long run. If we're going to keep trying to take her out, she's more powerful than we are. And so I think nature's going to win this thing. And most people don't like to think about it, especially if you're Christian, you have some other scenario about how it can happen. But also we need to be attached to reality. And reality is, and my final thought is, that we need to be taking care of the earth and learn to understand the earth differently than we have, than what a Western worldview offers. So thanks.
Thank you all. You've gone beyond the time that I originally asked, and I'm really appreciative of your generosity, your thoughtfulness, and the ways that you've engaged with us today. It's lovely to have you with us, and I hope that there will be opportunities in the future.
Thank you, Sandy.
Thank you. Thank you so much for organizing and for having us. Thank you to all the listeners that still hung on to us. Thank you very much.
Good to be together.
Bye-bye.